Okay, good morning. I will tell you about a project or several projects in our lab that have been going in the last few years that involve something that I think is really suitable for this audience because it's quite multidisciplinary, and it involves metal nanostructures and surface plasmons and the issue of chirality. And this work was carried out by several students during this last 4 years or so. Gabi started it, and he's now a postdoc at Weizmann. Lola did her master's, and she's now doing PhD in Cornell. Itai is now did also a master's, and is now at the Ibu University at some startup. And Asaf, who is here in the audience, is currently working on that. Most of what I will be talking about is a collaboration with a group at the Department of Biochemistry of Sasha Kotliar and several students and a postdoc in his group, and other people that we collaborated with on these issues are Ed Kosover and Itai Carmeli and Shachar Richter from our department. Okay, so general introduction on the subject. I'll start even more basically. Compared to the fantastic control that Fernando has, for example, on his nanomaterials, we are doing a very small but I think important control over nanostructures, and this is actually making them asymmetric. In the structures that you have previously seen, they have a high degree of symmetry, because this is what usually chemistry gives you. And actually destroying the symmetry of the nanostructures in a controlled manner is also an interesting challenge that recently people have been looking at it more. And this is very strongly related to biology, where actually low symmetry gives you a big advantage. For example, in molecular recognition, you do want to have a low degree of symmetry. So, okay, let's start with an introduction to chirality. Actually, I think chirality is something that doesn't really need to be introduced because it appears in probably all the fields of interest of people here. It's basically, you know, a mathematical symmetry concept, and very strongly appearing in chemistry and biology, but also I think in physics it appears, and even in engineering. Actually, yesterday there was one talk that mentioned the transmission line talk talked about. There was something about left-handed and right-handed materials there, but actually it's completely unrelated to chirality. Okay, so chirality, you know, the simplest way to explain chirality is by our hands. When you do you take, if you recovered from the beer and wine last night, so you can notice that if you take one hand and do a mirror reflection of that, you cannot superimpose the two to get the same, you know, they cannot overlap. So this is what chirality is about, the lack of mirror symmetry. And it appears a lot in organic molecules. So actually every molecule that has a carbon atom with four different groups attached to it has basically a chiral center. And in biological molecules, that like proteins, DNA, basically almost all biological molecules, you can find that. And there are also more exotic molecules that even don't have carbon atoms with four bonds, but still have helical structures. You know, helical structures are also chiral. It all started with Louis Pasteur, beginning of the 19th century. An important effect that chiral molecules have is that when you get one kind of one hand, molecules of one hand, one certain handedness, then they affect the polarization of light. When you pass light through these molecules, you will get a rotation of the plane of polarization of light. It's also called the circular birefringence. And you can think also about just random objects, not just molecules having chirality. Actually, it's very easy to get chirality in random objects. So we are interested in making nanostructures or inorganic nanostructures that will have chirality, not molecule, not small molecules. And one of the techniques that is used heavily in biology, and I will be also using it through the talk, is called circular dichroism. When you take those chiral molecules and you do not just take any, you know, arbitrary wavelength, but you take a wavelength where the molecule absorbs, so if the molecule is of a certain chirality, it will absorb differently right-handed and left-handed circularly polarized light. And the difference between the absorption of those two components will give rise to what is called the circular dichroism signal. And this technique is very important in biology because while the absorbance itself is not so sensitive to the structure of a molecule, to the angles, the bond angles, and so on, and the circular dichroism is very sensitive. And by using it, you can tell something about the conformation of molecules like proteins or DNA and follow their folding and changes in conformations. So in biology, it is used a lot. So this will be the tool that I will use to probe the chirality. And if you're talking about chiral structures, then there was quite a lot of work done previously on artificial chiral structures that were done by physical fabrication techniques, like all those, I don't know, patterns that have all kind of helical shapes or some asymmetry in them. And this issue is actually related to interesting to creating materials with interesting optical properties called metamaterials that have all kind of weird optical properties and can do all kind of strange things to light passing through them. And we are also thinking that it could be useful for biomolecular sensing biomolecules that have this property of chirality. And the other part is of the introduction is what are surface plasmons. So surface plasmons are special excitations that you can find in metals, at the surface of metals, and you can distinguish between two extreme cases. In one case, when you look at metal films that are on a scale that is much larger than the wavelength, then when light hits those films, it can excite electronic waves on the surface of the films that can propagate. And so these excitations are basically waves of the electrons that the electromagnetic radiation excites and can travel along the surface. So this is propagating surface plasmons. And also this is known to many biologists because it is used to sense biomolecules that are attached to the, for example, gold, usually gold films that people use for these instruments called the SPR also. The thing is here that it's difficult to excite the surface plasmons. You need to conserve momentum, and it requires heating the surface with a precise angle. And this you use this principle to detect biomolecules. I'm more interested in localized surface plasmons. When you make your metal nanostructures smaller than the wavelength, then you will get oscillations of the electrons, the free electrons of the metal that are localized. They cannot propagate anywhere, so they oscillate locally. They create high electromagnetic fields at the surface of the particle, and this high electromagnetic field, they act like optical antenna and can enhance all kinds of optical processes, as also Avraham Nitzan mentioned yesterday. And this gives rise to all kind of interesting optical enhancement effects. Okay, so to our point, we are interested, as I told you, to create artificial chiral nanostructures, and this is some background on this field that actually started around the year 2000, and I will be concentrating not on making chiral nanostructures by lithography, but by chemical techniques, using wet chemistry to create chiral nanostructures. And this field, is, I would say, started with this work in the year 2000, where a group at Georgia Tech found that if they make small gold clusters, small gold particles that have a few tens of atoms that are covered by a chiral molecule, this is a natural tripeptide called glutathione that has a cysteine amino acid that has a sulfur or SH thiol moiety that binds very strongly to the gold, then they get a circular dichroism response at wavelengths that do not correspond to the chiral molecule itself, but to the electronic states, or if you want, the plasmon excitations of this metal core. So this was kind of surprising because it was a new concept where the chiral molecule somehow induce chirality in this metal particle. And this group proposed a few explanations for this phenomena. I would say, of course, that the simplest thing is to try to say that somehow the chiral molecules induced or caused the metal atoms in this core of the particle to arrange in some chiral arrangement. But other people proposed other explanations, like the electronic interaction with something that is chiral with the achiral core that could induce something like that. And since then, there's a small community of people, also this Japanese group and others, that have studied. All of them focused on very small metal gold particles, basically, that are coated by chiral surfactants, which are bound through this sulfur gold bond, which is very strong, and try to understand exactly the mechanism of induction of chirality on this core. And I think there was an interesting breakthrough 3 years ago where a group at Stanford was able actually to create such a uniform sample of small particles that have 102 gold atoms at the core, and they could crystallize a supercrystal of these particles and take the X-ray structure of this. And even though in this specific case the surfactant molecules were not chiral, they could find in the X-ray that the core of the particle itself corresponded to a chiral symmetry group. But in this case, of course, you could get with equal probabilities the two different chiralities. But what is more important, they were able to find that the binding through this gold sulfur bond really distorted the outermost layer of the gold atoms in a chiral fashion, and this kind of now gave a good explanation of this appearance of chirality in the metal cores, and that is the distortion of the metal atoms by the chiral moiety. And there are some groups that now do calculations on these things, and they try to show that even without the capping surfactants, in some cases you can get chiral metal cores. And all this is based on the system reaching a minimum energy structure that is really a chiral. So our work has a different concept. First of all, in what I have shown you, those clusters are very small nanostructures, and the degree of chirality is small. And if we want to make interesting materials with interesting optical properties, we want to maximize the degree of chirality. You can find ways also to measure how much chirality you have in a structure by how dissymmetric it is. And we want to be able to make larger nanostructures that will have much stronger optical responses. And I think the concept that we have found can lead to something like that. And this is by making chiral metal nanoparticles in DNA. So and so this is a work that is based at Sasha Kotliar's lab, who are experts on making artificial DNA nanostructures. One of their expertise was to intercalate silver ions inside the DNA backbone. And so it, you can see by absorption and CD, for example, when you put, when you expose a simple, in this case, it's a, just poly-G, poly-C, a very simple DNA sequence of a few hundred base pairs, you expose it to silver ions under certain conditions, the ions go to fixed position, one ion per base pair, at the center of the DNA double helix, because the silver ions have very strong interaction with the bases of the DNA. And you can see some shift in the absorption because it changes a little bit the structure, and you can see how sensitive the CD is. For example, it completely changes the CD spectrum because of a slight change in conformation of the molecule. And then you can reduce the silver ions. Reducing is meaning putting some chemical agent that will give an electron to the silver ions, form silver atoms. And then an interesting thing happens. Once the silver is turned into, it is not no longer charged, so the atoms can move freely along the chain and find each other and form small clusters that can eventually grow to larger clusters. And you can follow this by different microscopies like AFM or TEM and so on, and get chains of silver metal particles along the DNA. And a later trick that we were applying is also cutting the DNA by an enzyme between the particles to separate the chains of particles to single isolated particles that are still coated on the, on, with the DNA, because the enzyme cannot remove the bits of DNA that are really coating the particles. And so the essence of the initial results that we got already 4 years ago is the following. Here you see the visible absorption of different stages of this process. The DNA itself, the red curve, absorbs only in the ultraviolet. The DNA with the AG slightly shifted. When you reduce the silver, you get a huge optical response in the visible, the blue part of the spectrum, which corresponds to the localized surface plasmon resonance of the silver particles. Those are particles of a few nanometers in size. And the interesting, amazing thing that happened is that when we measured the circular dichroism response of this, we could see that in addition to strong changes in the UV part, which corresponds to the DNA itself, we could see a huge response in the circular dichroism at the wavelength where only the silver absorbs. Okay, the same discovery as the one with the small gold clusters. But here the particles were much larger. Here actually we used much more silver than just one-to-one silver to DNA. And okay, we were able to publish this, and it was really intriguing. We could do also a control experiment where you take silver particles that were grown out of the DNA and then attach them to the DNA and show that there is no circular dichroism response. This is actually kind of cheating because it's a control experiment that helped us publish the paper, but it's not a real control because it's clear that the DNA, in the case where the particles were grown in the DNA, was changing its conformation severely around the particles, but in the control experiment probably it did not happen. They just attached on the outside of the DNA. So it was an interesting phenomenon, and I must say I will show you now more recent results, and we still do not really understand this. So for example, we could, if you saw the some TEM images that I showed you before, we get a large distribution of sizes of particles. So they can be as small as 1 nanometer. Some of them can be as large as 10 nanometers. So what we could do is, after cutting the DNA and separating the, isolating the particles, we could separate them according to size by different techniques like size exclusion or centrifugation. And then we could pinpoint what kind of or what size of particles are giving us the large chiral response. So after doing that, we found that a collection of particles that has roughly an average size of 1.7 nanometers, which corresponds to about particles of 150 silver atoms, are the ones that are giving us the large chiral optical response. And the much larger particles were not really participating in this. And this is now in press, but this is now the most recent results are really the most interesting ones. First of all, we were able, in this one, we did, for example, poly A, poly T, and we could see that there's not much difference between different sequences of the DNA in terms of getting the chiral response, although the shape of the plasmon resonance circular dichroism was changing a bit. But recently, we are now trying to narrow down and to try to understand really the mechanism of how the DNA induces the chirality in the particles. You could see that the particles are roughly spherical in shape. They are not getting helical shapes like the DNA or something like that. But now we are able to go down to very short single strands of DNA. For example, in this case, maybe the most pronounced one, 20 base, not base pairs, actually it's a mistake. It's just 20 base single strand of C, and obtain even a larger chiral response with particles of average size that is larger than 1.7 nanometers, probably 4 or 5 nanometers or more. Even here you see particles of 10 nanometers. And now we are starting to get much more uniform shapes, and you can see that the particles here already are showing some asymmetry in their structures. They have like I would say, a single crystal, more or less spherical core, but like a small bump on them that has very different crystal. It's actually a very bad crystal of silver. It's polycrystalline, and it's sitting on one side of the particle. So somehow, very different than what you expect from the DNA, as maybe if you would think about it as a hard template, like a helix that would induce some helical shape or something like that. A very peculiar folding of the DNA strands or some interaction causes the silver to deposit in a very strange way. And I must say that we are far from understanding how this thing works. So I want to conclude this part and go to the next part, the last part of the talk. So we have seen that somehow DNA induces a chirality in silver particles that are already larger than the previously prepared chiral particles of those small gold clusters with the thiol coating molecules. And that this is not, does not work as, like the DNA here is not working as a hard template, but it's a very unique way of folding or the molecules coating the silver particles. And we believe that the key point here, and this is actually a concept that Asaf, my student, brought up, that here it's not about getting a minimum stable, minimum energy structure, but the key factor here is actually the silver atoms diffusing along the DNA molecule and forming a structure that is basically kinetically controlled by the process. And we know also from different experiments that we do that the way we introduce the silver and the rate that by which we reduce and form those clusters appears to influence a lot the degree of chirality that we obtain. So we think that if we use such a highly asymmetric template like the DNA for the formation of the particles, it affects strongly the kinetics of their formation, and by this it induces a high asymmetry. Okay, so what I told you so far actually was an accident that on the way to do this part that I will tell you about now, a very interesting accident that we're still working with. But actually the original purpose of our study was the following project. The idea was actually to take an achiral silver particle to serve as an optical antenna to enhance the absorption of light in biological molecules, and by this to get an enhanced circular dichroism response, not of the metal but of the molecule itself, as a way to make circular dichroism measurements in biology more sensitive, to be able to detect lower concentrations of biological molecules or just to study them. Okay, so the idea here, as a proof of principle, we wanted to take a molecule that absorbs at about the same wavelength as the plasmon resonance of the silver particles, and to have some chiral part in the molecule, to have a circular dichroism, and to attach them together, and by this get an enhanced circular dichroism response of the molecule itself. The particle here is supposed to be completely, give zero circular dichroism, just act as an optical antenna. And I don't have much time, so I'll go just straight to the results. And I'll just show you what is the system. So we have the same glutathione that I mentioned before that was used for this chiral gold clusters. So we used it here together with some small chromophore, a molecular unit that is absorbing light at about 400 nanometers, the same as the surface plasmon of silver particles. And we form a hybrid of these two. And we compare the absorption. For example, the black curve here is just the absorption of the molecular part. Okay? The gray part of the curve is just the absorption of the silver particles with no molecule attached. And you see that the combined absorption of the two has a much larger response than just the algebraic sum of the two. This actually reflects an enhancement of the absorption of the molecule of about 70 times. And this is, I think, the first time that somebody really showed directly such a simple concept as using such an optical antenna to enhance the absorption of molecules. Most of the work so far concentrated on enhanced Raman scattering or enhanced fluorescence and so on. And we could also show that the circular dichroism response that before attachment to the silver particles was so weak was enhanced also by about 100 times. And there were also interesting fluorescence enhancement effects, but they are less interesting, I would say. More recently, we did the work with Shachar Richter and Itai Carmeli on a big protein called phosphosystem 1, you know, photosynthetic protein, that we also attached to silver and gold particles. Also there we were able to see enhancement, but much lower enhancement, which is expected because this enhancement is very strongly distance dependent, and once you have a 10 nanometer protein and the enhancement effect is of the order of nanometer 2, 3, something like that, you will enhance much less the absorption. So here it was just a small factor, but it was still interesting. And we also found out that in this particular case, the resonance of the absorption of the molecule and the silver particle was not particularly important. This is different from our finding in the previous work, actually. And, okay, I think by this I will conclude and leave time for questions. Thank you.
or better captive of the light in the interior.
Okay, I'm not sure I understood the question. You're saying that how do I know if the strong circle that refers to the first part of the talk? The second. So how do I know if I have a large... Yeah.
If you have a larger moment, is there or just the better coupling of the light?
Okay, I mean, it's basically the same mechanism, I would say. First of all, the explanation of this type of enhancement phenomena are not completely fully understood, and usually people divide them into two different mechanisms that are more or less like what I think your question was about. One is the pure electromagnetic enhancement, which is the plasmon oscillating and creating an enhanced electromagnetic field at the surface of the particle. And another one is called chemical mechanism that is related to the interaction of the molecule, like charge transfer or energy transfer between the molecule and the metal particle. And I don't know if this is exactly what you meant by your question, but those two things are going usually together and acting together, although the electromagnetic part is usually much stronger in its effect. It's related to the question how important is the resonance between the levels of the molecule and the plasmon. I don't know if it helped answering something.
Can you use this method of attaching a absorbing molecule also to excite the surface plasmon?
You mean through the absorption of the molecule to excite the surface plasmon? I think this is not such a realistic scenario, or not so important, because the optical cross-section of the particle is so much larger than the molecule that the reverse would be kind of insignificant usually. There's when you look at quenching of fluorescence, so you get something like that. You excite a molecule near the metal. I mean, if you look at a system that is non-resonant, probably you can tell more about this, because you can excite only the molecule and see how it loses the energy to the metal. But it's related to quenching, for example.